Hello, my friend, Pastor Curt here, and I got a question. What wears you out? I mean, what really sends you into nap time mode, exhausts your spirit? What's hard for you to do? You know, my son once said to me, he said, Dad, we were shopping in the mall at Christmas time. He said, Dad, how come I can rollerblade for like 4 hours? I can play with the dog for hours and hours. I can play a video game for hours and hours. But shopping in the mall for mom for 15 minutes makes me exhausted. I said, well, because you're wired like many men are wired. You don't like the shopping experience. Some activities, they energize us. And some activities, they drain us. I love fly fishing. I can hike up and down canyons, over rocks, through current all day long, and have energy at night to tell everyone fish stories about how big my fish really were. But there's some things, man, if I experience them, they immediately begin to deflate my life. In Hebrews chapter 12, the author identifies a few things that are really sucking the perseverance, the endurance, out of the believers being persecuted in this early church. Hebrews 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So much in this passage. What's the three things he's identified that are really sucking energy out of these young believers that he's writing to? The first one is isolation. In fact, the therefore describes the passage before that where he's talking about many, 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 many people. Why is he talking about so many people? He wants them to be connected, not isolated. The second thing is arguing. What does he talk about? Throwing off all the things, the hindrances. Well, these are debates and dramas in the church. And the third thing is aimlessness, not having a goal or a focus, or not having the right goal or the right focus. You know what's causing us to get so exhausted in this season of COVID? It's isolation. It's the drama of arguing. And it's aimlessness, not having direction, not having a way forward. How does he answer these? It's so brilliant. He says three things. Many other believers have made it through much worse. This is the point in this passage in Hebrews. Many other believers have persevered. My friend, you're not alone. Don't panic. Don't let exhaustion overwhelm you. You can get through this. Why? Because many other Christians have been through harder things and Jesus got them through. Point number two. Most current controversies entangle us instead of enable us. Okay, I don't know what you believe about masks. I don't know what you believe about our governor or our country or this controversy. And by the way, you should have convictions about all those things. I'm not saying don't think about that. I'm just saying don't make them the focus of your life. You know what I care about way more than masks or not masks? Souls. People coming to faith in this season where they're more open to hear that Christ loves them than maybe any other time in their whole life. Have convictions. Talk about them in a reasonable way, but don't let all of these side controversies and emails and links and this person said this and this person taught this and did you see this clip on you? Don't let that entangle you. Now is the time to love people well, not be involved in so many side controversies. Most people have gotten through much worse, most Christians, and most issues are going to entangle us, not enable us. And here's the third thought. All believers have been appointed just for this moment. He says, for such a time as this, he says that you and I have been marked out for this race exactly. Why were you born during a time when COVID would happen? Why are you born during a time when cultural chaos would happen? Because you have something to contribute. All of us are called into this moment. You're gonna hear some things from your church, your campus, from Bayside in general, about how we're gonna go from the defensive to the offensive. We're going to go out and unleash good deeds to create goodwill so the good news can actually change lives. We're not going to shrink back. We're going to look at what Christ did for the joy set before him, and we're going to move forward. I want to ask you to join us. If you've not been joining us on the weekend for a service, make a commitment to do so, either on site or online, baysideonline.com. And I tell you what, if you've let a little bit of space get between you and getting to church, whether on site or online, I want to encourage you to recommit yourself. For the joy set before him, Christ moved forward. We are not alone, and we are called to this moment. Let's get rid of any side dramas and go get some stuff done for God. And in that way, we're going to persevere. In that way, we're going to make it. And in that way, we're going to see lives changed.